I got the car during, it was actually a particularly low moment in my life when I was struggling. I was working two jobs and playing clubs with my band. And it was actually my father, who is also a huge car guy, knew exactly what I needed and said, "Greg, I think you need to buy yourself a sports car. I think that's gonna make this better." Went out looking, and initially I sort of thought what I really wanted was maybe the first gen CRX, because they're so light and nimble and the handling is so good. But I was just really disappointed in the power. And when I test drove a 90, I was really, really satisfied with the power. I thought it was the perfect balance of the lightweight, the handling, the tossability, nimbleness, but with just enough power to make it really fun. My name is Greg Bruce, and I drive a 1991 Honda CRX SI. I've never really had a philosophy that a vehicle or anything that I bought should remain the way it is. I've always believed that if I can extract more pleasure out of this thing by changing it to suit my needs, I don't see any problem with that. Influenced from my fathers and my uncles who talked about driving Mini Coopers in England, my dad owned a Sunbeam Alpine. The concept of the lightweight, but with the small engine, you know, lightweight package with just the right amount of power was exactly what I needed to really enjoy a car. I've had people say to me, "Why on earth did you not just do a B swap? 2 liters, 200 horsepower, you spent all this money building a D series to only get 150 horsepower." But to me, that lightweight power plant with 150 horsepower in a lightweight car with as much rubber as I can get on the ground, I think it's perfect. Engine-wise, the bottom end is the original bottom end, the original block. It's an A6 block. The rods are A6, but they were new and then shot peened to be a little bit stronger with Wiseco pistons. We estimate the compression at 12.6 to 1. We went for the 2.6 level busy moto cam with the appropriate header that matched with it. I don't like the angry bees crying baby Honda sound. I like it to sound a little richer and chocolatier. It took a lot of experimentation to get it to there. But I'm kind of picky like that. I like the engine exhaust sound to be lower frequency, not screechy. And I think it should have, you know, on VTEC and or at least at Watt, I think if it has a little bit of that, a little bit edge of raspiness, like tearing fabric or something in the tone. And I want to actually hear the engine mixed with the exhaust. I don't want to just hear loud exhaust, and I don't want to just hear engine internal spinning around. Sort of a balance. In when I teach band, we say we want a balance and blend between the sections. And I think that's the experience that I want from a car. I think with the racing seats and with the sound, sometimes in the summer, I just really enjoy driving slow and just enjoying rolling out in the car and listening to it and noticing that little kids are pointing at it. I enjoy that. So, you know, they're like, "Whoa, look at that." And that's kind of cool. I'm a school teacher. I teach music mostly. Most kids, the general reaction is, "Mr. Bruce, for such a big guy, why do you drive such a small car?" And then I have to explain to them the concept of, you know, smaller, lightweight, shorter wheelbase cars. They turn in so well, they handle so well, they're so fun to drive. Then I usually get something like, "Yeah, but you could have bought a BMW. So, that, and I think what that is it's, you know, for most high school kids, cars are status. They're not the driving experience. The only driving experience they've had is a video game. First started driving in the late 80s and early 90s when I first got my license. Street racing was a really, really big thing here in the Lower Mainland, and it was not import cars. We'd all meet up at the Shell station, and then they'd say, "Okay, we're going here," and we'd all follow, and then the Chevelles and the Novas and the Mustangs would all line up. And my perspective at that time was, you know, this is racing. But then times changed, and street racing became sort of vilified, and maybe rightfully so. People started getting hurt, and there were major incidences that I think it also helped open the eyes of authorities, and people realized we need to have, you know, sanctioned autocross events, driver training. We need to have track days at local tracks. And so my dad, first of all, took me to a BMW car club, accidents avoidance, collision avoidance course. That was it. And it was, you know, it was pretty basic. It wasn't like being on a racetrack. But then that segued to autocross. That segued on to track days. And then my first one was 3 years ago, a legit track day. That just, I remember coming home, and I went to the Starbucks on the way home and picked up my phone, and I said to my wife, oh, I just had the most amazing day of my life. And she's like, better than your wedding day? And I said, my second most amazing day of my life. And ever since, I can't wait to get back to the track. That's definitely where I've had the most fun. I really want people to understand and believe it, that coming out to these kind of events in a stepped up kind of series, start with simple car control, eventually to track days and then more sophisticated track days, it will make you a far better driver on the street. It'll make you more alert. It'll make you understand what your car is going to do when something unexpected happens. If we could get more guys in the community participating in these things and overcoming whatever the challenges are, you can have a lot of fun. I think it would build the whole community. It would bring us together. And I guess that's something that I think is important to say.